Hello, everyone, and welcome to our webinar, DK School and Library Fall Preview Event. I am Ronny Khuri, a senior editor at Booklist. My pronouns are he and him. And before we begin, I will go over some technical details. Links to today's slide presentation and title list were included in a reminder email you received from Zoom 1 hour ago. If you'd like to download them, you can open that email, scroll to the bottom, and click on the links located there. You can also download the slides and title list by typing the URLs on this screen into your web browser. If you have any trouble accessing these materials, please contact us at webinars@booklistonline.com. If you are in the audience, you are in listen-only mode, but we definitely welcome any questions that you may have. So if you look to the bottom of your Zoom screen, you'll find a toolbar with a button for Q&A. If you have a question, if you need technical assistance, you can just click Q&A and type your message into the box that pops up. We will do our best to respond to all of the tech-related questions, and then we can pass along all other questions to today's panelists, and they will have an opportunity to follow up with you after the webinar. We also offer closed captioning on our webinars. So to enable or disable captions on your screen, you can go back to that toolbar at the bottom, look for the captions icon and click that. From there, you can select show or hide captions from the menu that appears. If you choose to enable the subtitles, you can then adjust the size of the captions at any time by selecting caption settings. And finally, Booklist does expect all participants to maintain a respectful atmosphere, and anyone who violates this standard may, at the discretion of the organizers, be removed. But we do have a wonderful program for you today. A little later, I will have the privilege of speaking with Rebecca Walker about her new picture book, Time for Us. But first, I am going to hand things over to Rebecca Tsang, the marketing coordinator at DK, for a little book buzz. So please take it away, Rebecca.
Thank you, Ronny. And hi, everyone. Thank you all so much for being here today. I'm Rebecca Tsang, the Senior Marketing Associate for Education and Library at DK. Like you, I am super excited to hear the Q&A with author Rebecca Walker of Time for Us. But before that, I'm looking forward to sharing with you some of DK's most exciting and forthcoming titles coming this fall. So let's begin by diving into DK's adult titles. First, I'd like to start with a special shout out to DK's New York Times bestselling books of 2023 and 2024, Texture Over Taste by Joshua Wiseman, Baking Yesteryear by B. Dylan Hollist, Safe and Sound by Mercury Stardust, Knife Drop by Nick DiGiovanni, Healthy Girl Kitchen by Danielle Brown, and Meals She Eats by Rachel and Tom Sullivan. Plus, our New York Times bestselling list has grown in 2024 to include Old Time Hockey's Recipes from the Cedar Swamp by Old Time Hockey and You Deserve Good Gelato by Casey Rose, who you actually might remember from the author Q&A at DK's Summer 2024 preview a few months ago. So congratulations to all of our authors and their wonderful books. Now let's dive into our fall list with some cookbooks. I just had my lunch, so my stomach is not growling, but no promises to you when you hear about these books. Holly Nilsson's blog, Spend with Pennies, has been a go-to resource for tried and true family recipes for over a decade. In her debut cookbook, Holly shares 25 top recipes from her blog alongside 90 plus brand new recipes. From Moroccan spiced chicken couscous bowls to hearty ground beef stew with rosemary dumplings, Holly's deliciously comforting recipes make cooking dinner feel not only achievable, but also deliciously enjoyable. Next, from one of the internet's most captivating and creative culinary content creators comes Albert Can Cook, a debut cookbook exploding with out-of-the-box flavor combinations, fast food classics remixed, and dishes inspired by your favorite TV shows. Albert not only can cook, but he'll bring his skills to your kitchen. For the first time, fans will be able to try his internet-famous creations like mozzarella donuts, Big Mac burritos, Deadpool pizza, and more. Plus, this cookbook is spiral-bound and foldable to prop up on its own, which is the perfect format for easy kitchen use. Nothing tastes quite as soothing and delicious as an old-fashioned indulgence, and Larry Cannon's quick and easy, delicious milkshakes have provided millions of viewers with just that. Join one of TikTok's most comforting creators and his trusty blender to make every day a Milkshake Monday. This cookbook covers classic shakes, happy hour boozy creations, shakes brimming with nostalgic cereals and candy, and so much more. Featuring 100 plus easy recipes for feeding little ones, this special cookbook comes from the mind of Lily Payen, the mother behind the popular baby-led weaning website Feeding Tiny Bellies. Lily guides readers through the weaning journey, addressing commonly asked questions and providing advice for parents of picky eaters, children with allergies, and more. From strawberry oatmeal bars to avocado chicken salad to Parmesan crusted salmon, Feeding Tiny Bellies is the one-stop shop for creating recipes the whole family will love. So chances are you've seen Cecilia Baumdahl's enchanting social media videos of her life on Svalbard, a wintry archipelago in the Arctic Ocean near the North Pole. Cecilia, her partner Christopher, and her dog Grim have adjusted to life at the top of the world, where polar bears roam free and northern lights shine bright. With spectacular photography and personal stories, Cecilia's story begins in the darkness of the polar night, and the beauty of Svalbard is revealed gradually as sunlight returns months later. Wherever you live, life on Svalbard will give a deeper understanding of why people choose to live in extreme environments and perhaps help readers find the hidden magic of where they live too. Knowledge is adventure, and with DK, you can always choose a new adventure to go on. In Manga Drawing School, learn how to create contemporary and inclusive manga artworks with experienced teacher, artist, and YouTube sensation Mei Yu. From simple faces to action-packed scenes, this guide covers over 100 lessons to elevate your skills no matter what level. With Compost, learn how to make compost gold from the master of healthy soil, Charles Dowden. Learn how to use kitchen and garden waste to make homemade compost that will help your plants truly flourish in ways that fit your space. Art Annotated is a stunning art gallery wrapped into one book, spanning 3,000 years of paintings, sculptures, prints, and more. Art Annotated explores art and artists from around the world, all set in their historical contexts. This is the ultimate history of art and visual sourcebook for art lovers. A History of Ghosts, Spirits, and the Supernatural charts the extraordinary narratives of one of the most fascinating subjects in the world, covering everything from ancient necromancy to modern-day ghost hunting and creepypasta tales to the Envoy and La Llorona of Latin America. This spellbinding book details the numerous ways in which the spirit world has been depicted across myth, religion, folklore, literature, art, and more. Cosmos takes readers on a captivating tour through space, from the solar system to the Milky Way and the realm of distant galaxies. Featuring the latest images from NASA and Mars probes, Cosmos ignites the wonders of the universe for young and experienced astronomy lovers alike. Packed with full-color photographs and detailed illustrations, the Pregnancy Encyclopedia is an engaging and accessible guide to some of the most commonly asked questions about pregnancy. This comprehensive guide covers over 300 pregnancy-related topics, all explored in depth. Immerse yourself in the action-packed world of DC in one spectacular, one-of-a-kind book, DC Cinematic Universe. From the trailblazing 1940s movie serials that first put Batman and Superman on the screen to the 21st century reinventions of The Dark Knight and Wonder Woman, this book provides an indispensable guided tour of DC cinema history. So featured here are the latest upcoming books to DK's beloved Big Idea series. A brand new addition to the series, the Design Book, alongside updated editions of the Philosophy Book, the Economics Book, and the Politics Book. With striking visuals and engaging writing, this series makes big topics and complicated concepts easy to digest and understand. Our latest addition to the English for Everyone series is English for Everyone Everyday English, which covers a wide range of real-life scenarios, from going to the supermarket and making appointments to dealing with conflict, welcoming visitors, and more. With more than 1,500 useful phrases and common expressions, this comprehensive and highly visual guide gives learners the English conversation skills they need to get by in the real world. Now, let's talk travel. So whether you've dreamed of traveling coast to coast in an RV, or simply want to roll down your car window and plug in a classic playlist, Road Trips in the USA is a celebration of riding the open road. With 50 epic driving routes, maps, and practical information, taking the scenic route has never been easier. DK also has exciting new additions to the DK Eyewitness Travel Guides, covering Japan, Australia, Morocco, New York City, Cuba, and many more places. With color-coded chapters, practical tips, and detailed maps, this series will ensure you don't miss a thing on any adventure around the world. Plus, check out the latest additions to our popular DK Eyewitness Top 10 series, including Mexico City, Lisbon, Singapore, Venice, and more. With simple, up-to-date themed lists of 10 that cover the best of each city, these pocket-friendly guides will help you make the most of your time and travels. Plus, DK's Spanish language publishing list continues to grow both on our adult and children's side. Highlighted here are just a few of this year's forthcoming and newest edition of our books in Spanish. Now, let's continue with our children's titles, beginning with our decodable books. Phonic Books, as you may know, offers an exciting range of truly decodable books for beginner readers and older readers. With multiple series that build on learned letter sound knowledge, they pave a structured scaffold that can be effectively integrated into any phonics instruction program. This September, we'll be publishing two new nonfiction book sets and their accompanying activity books, Dandelion World Vowel Spellings and Dandelion World Extras, Stages 8 through 15. We'll also be publishing three instructional manuals for kindergarten, grade 1, and for our catch-up readers. These guides provide an explanation of phonics, an overview of our series, and guidance for pronunciation, letter formation, and high-frequency words. The manuals also provide structured lesson plans filled with engaging and effective activities that are easy to implement in the classroom or at home. Plus, this is just a reminder that the following phonic books, beginner and catch-up series, are available in library binding. Next in the phonics realm is our new series, DK Super Phonics. This fall, we'll be publishing several titles in this super cute DK Super Phonics series, starting with my first decodable stories, Pet Shop Panda. Each of these box sets for beginner readers will include 8 books with fun stories that focus on essential first sounds. The individual books also contain a word list for blending practice, discussion questions, and a game to enjoy together. Plus, don't miss out on A Parent's Guide to Phonics, an accessible, jargon-free book for caregivers that explains how written language is put together, what phonics are, and how reading and spelling are taught using a structured approach. So our beloved DK Super Reader series continues into 2024. DK's new and improved nonfiction leveled reader series is designed for kids ages 3 to 11 and divided into 5 levels from pre-level to level 4, all aligned to Lexile measures. First up is the series Animals with Attitude. The first two books in this new Super Reader series are Dog Dude and Snarky Shark, which are as fun as the covers look. And I personally love that shark's giant grin, because what snark is that shark thinking? I'd love to know. This series combines high-interest animal facts with level text and lots of laughs, which appeal to even the most reluctant readers. We're also publishing new readers across 5 levels covering social studies, history, and culture topics. These include A Coyote's Tale, An Eagle's Tale, A Mustang's Tale, An Arctic Childhood, Matoka, The True Story of Pocahontas, Reservation Life Today, and A History of Jazz. Plus, we'll be adding to our collection the Spanish editions of Journey Through Ellis Island and Harlem Renaissance, as well as a Spanish-English bilingual edition of History of Hawaii. All Super Readers are available in hardcover and paperback. So for more information, visit the DK Super Readers website, available on this slide and also on the back of every reader via a QR code. This site houses tons of information and free downloadable resources for parents, educators, and librarians that will help kids become the reading heroes they are. Next, I'd like to highlight several new titles coming to the A Kid's Book About series, which explores conversations on the important yet often more difficult parts of life. Topics in this series are handled mindfully, and the books are meant for children as young as 5. This fall, the books coming out will be A Kid's Book About Change, Voting, and Diversity. An Anthology of Exquisite Birds is the next book in our beloved DK Anthology series. From the miniature bee hummingbird who flaps its wings 200 times a second, to the oil bird who navigates pitch black caves using echolocation, this collection showcases more than 90 amazing birds with lively prose and gorgeous illustrations. Like the others in the series, this book will feature foil on the cover, gilded edges, and a ribbon for keeping your place. Plus, we'll be publishing an anthology of rocks and minerals and an anthology of fungi. These books are smaller and therefore more transportable, yet still packed with profiles of different specimens, making them the perfect companion for kids who love spotting natural treasures hidden in our everyday world. Next, for the kids who want to dip into browsable reference, look no further than DK Eyewitness. As you may know, we've updated the Eyewitness series with a new look, more facts, and more fun for today's generation of kids. However, this series still maintains that same well-loved approach of visually stunning, immersive knowledge built around a singular topic. This fall, we'll be adding 2 new books to this popular and beloved series, Eyewitness Animal and Eyewitness Night. STEM Activity Lab is an action-packed book of activities that are perfect for firing up kids' imaginations. Perfect for library programming and both classroom and at-home learning, this richly illustrated and fact-filled book guides young readers through fun experiments that satisfy curiosity, engage problem-solving skills, and demonstrates how STEM shapes the world around us. So millions of kids have joined Dad Rob and his family on YouTube to learn how to draw. Draw with Art for Kids' unique, easy-to-follow approach puts fun first and encourages kids to draw in their own way and to be proud of the results. With two books already out in the series, we'll be publishing Draw with Art for Kids Hub Christmas this fall. And here's just an exclusive sneak peek at some of the fun pages in this holiday edition. Who would not want to draw kitty cat stocking stuffer? And so I don't make the rules. We all know that after 4th of July, it's basically Halloween, which is basically the winter holidays. So put on your mittens and let's continue with the festivities. First up is Minecraft Festive Ideas, a book featuring 50 plus fun and festive builds, including a gingerbread house, a family of penguins, a snowball fight arena, and much more, making this the perfect book for creative fans during the holidays. We also have The Very Young Person's Guide to Christmas Carols. Follow Arthur and Holly on an adventure to save Christmas as they explore gorgeous scenes inspired by some of the most beloved carols. Prepare to sing along because included are sound buttons that bring 10 iconic music clips to life. For board books, we have new additions to the Baby's First series, Baby's First Christmas and Baby's First Valentine's Day. Specially made for little hands, DK's hard-wearing early learning board books are clear and easy to follow, perfect for a seasonal read-along. The latest book in our popular timeline series is Timelines of Extraordinary Lives, which features more than 150 visual timelines that take young readers on unforgettable journeys through the lives of the great, the terrible, and the often overlooked people in world history. Through easy-to-understand timelines and vibrant illustrations, this book features the lives of queens and kings, humanitarians, scientists, inventors, explorers, activists, writers, artists, and much more. Now I'd like to introduce you to a few of DK's newest encyclopedias for kids coming out this fall. Why Encyclopedia provides brilliant answers to baffling questions. This book's 3D illustrations and interactive Q&A format creates a fun approach to a number of core topics, from climate change and cavemen to the pyramids and pandemics. Knowledge, a visual compendium, breaks down big topics in engaging and accessible ways. With this gorgeous reference book, kids will discover the 40 orders of birds, the 88 constellations, the 36 Morse code symbols, the 118 chemical elements, the 206 bones in the human body, and the list goes on. History as it happened is a children's history atlas like no other. With more than 200 specially commissioned maps covering global and inclusive content from history, readers will follow key moments from the growth of the Roman Empire to the sea routes of explorers around the world and more. Embark on an illuminating journey through the history of knowledge and communication with The History of Information, the debut nonfiction book by bestselling author and illustrator Chris Hogton. A fascinating read for both children ages 8 plus and even adults like myself, this gorgeously illustrated book narrates the story of information, from the first languages and cave paintings to how we record and communicate information through technological progress today. And of course, last but certainly not least, is Time for Us by best-selling author, activist, and mother, Rebecca Walker, whom I am so excited for you all to hear from in just a couple of minutes. Did you know that spending 20 minutes of quality time a day with a child in your life can result in infinite benefits for all? From taking a walk to sharing the discovery of the tiniest hummingbird, Time for Us is a beautiful celebration of our most precious human resource, the time we spend together. Now, before I pass this back to Booklist, here's just a quick reminder to follow DK to receive our latest news. Whether you're interested in children's or adult books, we are here to keep you posted. And for any school librarians, check out our education-focused site, DK Learning, which is packed with curated free downloadables and lesson plans. And be sure to follow us on our education-focused socials as well. Thank you all so much for joining this event and for all that you do for your communities. We truly appreciate you. And now I am so excited to pass this back to Booklist for the live Q&A portion of this event with author Rebecca Walker. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Rebecca. And thank you, DK. Again, I am Ronny, an editor over at Booklist, and it is my pleasure to bring on another Rebecca Walker, who has joined us, as you can see. Rebecca Walker is many things, including a writer, producer, and full-time mama who believes the discovery of beauty, compassion, and resilience is at the heart of the parenting journey. With her son now in college, she looks forward to creating many more children's books inspired by the magical time they spent together before he left home, and the closeness possible when parents and children make time to connect. Thank you so much for taking the time to be here, Rebecca.
Oh, I'm thrilled to be here. Thanks so much for having me.
So we heard a bit from DK's Rebecca about Time For Us, but for those who aren't super familiar, and just to kick things off, can you give us a general intro to Time For Us, the concept, the story?
Sure. So I'm a writer and a teacher of writing. And one of the things that I teach is that all books have both a story and a situation. So the story is what the book is really about, right? The heart. And the situation is where all of that story plays out. Time For Us is really about two people who really want to spend time together and who are trying to figure out a way to overcome obstacles so that they can spend time together. Time For Us, the situation of it is, you know, a mom and a son who both want to spend time together. And the thing they have to overcome is mom's need to work and her son's need to learn how to be patient and how to respect the boundary that mom has set and just wait. And so they manage to overcome this obstacle and enter into a magical world together and spend the time together that they've longed for. And that magical world is a garden that is full of gorgeous flowers and hummingbirds and really, most importantly, this garden represents time. They're actually able to enter into the vast expanse of time, which itself is magical.
Beautiful, thank you. I'm going to ask you more about time a little later. But before we dig into the details of the story itself and the situation itself, I want to zoom out just for a moment. Okay. Just to introduce, kind of by way of introduction, of you and your journey to children's books, because this is your debut. You're new in this space technically. But in your past work, you've most often kind of spoken to adults or to the culture at large. And so I wonder if you can draw a path to today and talk about what inspired you at this point in your career to turn your attention to children.
Oh, great question. So any of my readers know I've always written about my life, my personal life. I have a really strong belief that whatever's happening to me has got to be happening to millions of other people, that none of us are having an experience alone. And that often when you share your own experience with other folks, you resonate and build a community around those challenges or around those experiences. And I'm always looking to build community and also to offer whatever I've managed to glean from my experience in the hopes that it will support other people. So my son was on his way to college and I felt this kind of emotional longing to kind of hold on to our connection as he went out into the world. And I thought, oh, I'm sure lots of other moms and parents feel this way too. And so why don't I write a story that is about our connection and about the challenges that we've had in maintaining our connection and the ways in which we've been successful at doing it. So I'm working on another piece of adult nonfiction, but I thought I'm feeling really moved and really sort of alive to this experience that's happening right now. So let me just get this out. And I've always loved children's books, you know, and they've been a real special gift for me and my son. We spent many, many hours, I'm sure many of you parents out there have, you know, at night, during the day, going into this special intimate world of reading together. So it just seemed right, you know, as he was leaving, to kind of bring him home in a way through this work.
Yeah. So that's a great segue, just as kind of both of us being parts of the picture book world and our audience being picture book nerds. What are some of those picture book influences or favorites, or did you find any like mentor texts that you were looking at when you wrote this one?
That's a great question. You know, my wife is a fiction writer and she's always focused on plot, you know, and I'm a nonfiction writer. So I'm always focused on sort of psycho, you know, emotional evolution and the reflective meditative space of trying to come into some awareness of your life and and your experience. And when I was writing this book, she kept saying, well, you know, more needs to happen. And I said, well, you know, honey, our favorite books are the quiet books, you know, the ones in which not a lot happens. And what's really happening when we're reading is we're sinking into being together, not necessarily, you know, needing for this to happen. So I was thinking about some of the books that we loved. We loved Eric Roman's books, Clara and Asha. Cinder-Eyed Cats were favorites. I love the Taro Gomi books, very simple, you know, bus stop, where you're just like looking at bus stops, you know, and these beautiful drawings. Donald Cruz was a favorite, incredible African-American illustrator, artist. You know, we loved his book, Freight Train. You know, mm-hmm. It's just Freight Train, you know. Blue caboose, you know, I mean, just very slow, very poetic. A Snowy Day, you know, Keats, gorgeous. The Giving Tree, obviously. So there wasn't a real template for this, but I definitely wanted the book to be much more about the emotion of connection. Than something happening, even though a lot happens in the book, you know, really, but it's more, let's sink into this mother-son experience. You know, that's what's really happening. They're connecting.
Yeah. You're absolutely right. And at least in my experience that there, I don't know of any templates for a book like this. It felt very unique in its structure and its approach. Mm-hmm. It's a family story, but it's a lot more than that as well. You're doing kind of multiple things. So I wanted to talk for a moment about your process and your approach to kind of the picture book form, because it is sort of its own thing in the world of literature, kind of poetry and narrative and visuals and this kind of really interesting blend. So I'm just curious if that was a challenge for you as far as how to approach that form and what kind of new considerations you were taking into account considering your new audience.
Yeah. It actually was a challenge, you know, and I had to really lean into my memory of the patterns of our lived life together, you know. I had to really kind of think about how we spoke to one another, you know, Tenzin and I, and kind of immerse myself again in our world so that I could communicate and describe it and share it effectively. And that was challenging, you know, not to get back into the world, but how to translate it to young people, you know, how to make sure that I wasn't being overly simplistic, making sure that there was enough of the mom, you know, sort of talking, you know, trying to figure out point of view, which was a great question. You know, who's telling this story? Who's the main character of this story? How can I, how do I do this? It was basically, how do I do this? I mean, to be completely honest, you know, when I wrote my first memoir, I read 1,000 memoirs, you know, it was like, okay. And I figured it out. I figured out how I could innovate on the form, you know, because I read so many. And with this, I guess it was the same, but, you know, I don't know. I don't know if this is very helpful. It was tough. It was a tough journey. You know, there was a lot of repetition because I wanted the repetition of the children's books we loved. I love as a parent, you know, again and again, I think the kids love that rhythm. But then at some point, there were just too many of those. I had to cut them. Then there were 100, like Mama says, and then Jackson says, and then, you know, then it was like, do we use quotes? You know, do we not use quotes? It was very different. And it was much wordier initially. I mean, it was like, you know, paragraphs. So distilling all of that down to the essential lines was a challenge, you know. Yeah. So especially when they're learning about things, you know, they're going out into the garden and Mama is saying, you know, well, what about that plant, what is that called and what does that do? And, you know, and I wrote reams about, like, you know, what ginger does and how it helps you digest food. And and then it was like, no, you know, Jackson can just say, that's ginger, and that's what we drink when our stomach is upset, you know, when our belly's hurt. And so getting to the pith, getting to the poetry without going too deeply into the poetry was a challenge, you know? It's like either too spare or too wordy. It was tough. I you know, I have to think more about that. It was a challenge. But I think we did a good job. I had a great editor. She was super helpful.
And I appreciate you admitting that, because it is a challenging form and it is a very different form. And like you said, at every point in this book, it is doing that family story. But in the meantime, it's also like a very useful activity list of things a kid could do. Or it's a guide to nature in a very specific kind of corner of the world. Were those kind of sub elements always a part of your plan, or did they just sort of come out of the process?
Completely a part of the plan. You know, when I was a mom, working mom at home, I always was trying to figure out what the heck to do with my kid. You know what I mean? I was not one of those parents who was like, you know, wanting to hang out for hours and draw and wanting to play with cars and trucks and, you know, wanting to stage mini plays with stuffed animals. Like, I was just not that mom. You know, the idea of playing with my kid, honestly, like, you know, playing in this formal way just made me want to just give up on life, you know. So anyway, so when I was writing the book, I thought, you know, I'd love to give moms and kids some ideas for things to do, you know. And you know, eventually we want to do more of the books and maybe a deck of cards with different activities, like very simple things, you know, lie down on the ground and watch the clouds, you know, talk about the clouds. What do you see in the clouds? Where do clouds come from? Simple, simple things that I would want to do too, you know, not just things that I think he would want to do. So I was definitely thinking about that. I was thinking also about, helping parents to find things that are appealing and captivating off screens. I'm not anti-screen, but I think that it's important that we find some analog things to do, you know, and more we're kind of forgetting that there are analog things to do. So I wanted the book to be a reminder to just, you know, smell air, taste water, look at a flower, you know, even in the city, like look at that little, you know, weed growing in the crack in the sidewalk, you know, just point that out. Look at that weed, you know, look at that green. You're like that. Are you like that? How hard do you think it is for that little thing to grow, just to remind kids. You know, I was thinking, someone was telling me that some kids think milk comes from a carton. Like, you know, they don't, they're not connected to the cow. Like, they actually think, you know, okay, the milk is, that's where the milk is made, in this carton. You know, so that's alarming. And so it's, again, it's this idea of reminding children and parents of the earth, you know.
Yeah. So you mentioned the magical garden, and of course the ultimate activity is going outside and engaging with the world. Was there a certain process or inspiration behind the specific items you selected, the plants or the flowers? Was that from your experience, or was that educationally oriented, or?
And totally from our experience. We were living on Maui. I had this vision when my son was born that I wanted to give him this, you know, completely idyllic tropical childhood, you know, like so many of us do. We want to give our kids, you know, this paradise, right? And so we moved to Maui, and it was wonderful for many years, and we were there together until Tenzin was about 8 or 9. And it was funny because at about eight, he said, you know, Mom, I'm not really into all this tropical paradise. He was like, you know, I actually like the city. I don't want to surf. I'm not that into the, you know, the kelp in the ocean is kind of gross. So anyway,
of that course. Was funny.
Yeah, right. Exactly. Total parenting. So, but the book is definitely taken from our lives on Maui. And I did want to kind of honor that place and the magic that is there. We had all of those plants in our yard. We didn't have a huge yard, but they were there anyway somehow, and we could walk to this incredible kind of end of the world moment where we could see the ocean together. So we did that a lot. So I feel really grateful that we were able to spend that time there, and that I could bring it into this book, you know, because I think we all need a little break. Who doesn't want to go to Maui, you know, for 20 minutes a day, you know? And as a way to kind of give that place and that experience back to us. I think my son really thinks of it as his first home, and leaving it, even though he said he wanted to, I think was tough. You know, now that he's older and understands how magical it was. So to be able to give him this incredible portrait from that time is very meaningful to me, you know, and to be able to share it with other people is out of control, crazy bananas, amazing. You know, when I was at the ALA conference in San Diego in June, I saw the book for the first time. And I was able to give it to many librarians and parents of different types. And I became so emotional just talking to them about how excited they were to read it to the young people in their lives, to their students, to their kids, to their grandkids. Because the idea of being in that special place, you know, was just an unbelievable gift. You know, the idea that something that I was able to create with my child, and that he was able to create with me, that we were able to make together, that we would now be a part of the bonding and the intimacy that is created through the reading and sharing of story, is just like beyond, you know. I feel like it's the best of all of my books. It's like, it just has given me so much joy to think about, you know, to be a part of the future in that way, you know, the present and the future. It's like unbelievable. So yeah, so Maui, all that.
That's a beautiful way of putting it. I've never heard it put quite like that, but of course it makes sense. And picture books so often gloss over setting. It'll be clearly contemporary, but it'll be somewhat generic. And I think having such a specific and personal element to the setting created just an extra layer of depth and meaning and just beauty of it. And I think that connects really well to, we have to talk for a moment about the illustrations because it is a picture book. And the illustrator is Maria Diaz Pereira, who knocked it out of the park and created just this glowing, beautiful landscape. And just the tone of it is so... So usually when I read a picture book, just I'm text oriented. So I'll read the text and then I'll start over and I'll just read the pictures. And then I'll try to kind of analyze it from that standpoint. And I read the pictures and I was kind of trying to determine what was the core essence of it. And the word that came to mind was sunlight. And then I did another reread and I read the first sentence. And I think the first line was like, the sun is shining. And I was like, oh, of course, like that is sort of the essence of this book. Anyway, tell us just how, I assume you sent your manuscript off and received pictures in return at some point, but maybe that wasn't your experience. But what was the experience of seeing those images for the first time?
Well, first of all, that's such a lovely idea, you know, to read the pictures first, then to read the text. And I agree with the sunlight and the sunshine and how that is so deeply a part of the book. So anyway, seeing the pictures, the drawings for the first time was just unbelievably powerful. I was so moved. Again, I mean, I tend to be more emotional as I get older, apparently. So I, you know, my tears welled up. But I had sent Maria many photographs of our time together, you know, me and my son and all of our activities. And she managed to pull so many of the most important things, you know, like Piggy. My son has 20 piggies, or he did. Well, he still has one or two, but he, you know, he loved his Piggy, you know. So Piggy went everywhere for many, many years. And she managed to get Piggy in there in a wonderful way. His train, you know, the flowers, her drawings just brought everything alive in a way that it's just, it was like supernatural. It was a miracle. You know, we had looked at many, many illustrators before choosing Maria, and I really wanted to work with an illustrator of color, an illustrator who could understand skin tone and understand hair texture and understand, you know, hips and understand movement in a certain way, and the gravitas of the relationship and of the place. And that was hard to find, you know, someone who could do all of that. And she managed to, I think, do all of that. Yep. And she doesn't speak any English. I mean, oh. She speaks some English, but not a lot of English. She lives in Spain. She speaks Spanish. I speak some Spanish, you know, pretty good Spanish, actually. But we managed to do all of it, you know, kind of cross-culturally, bilingually. You know, I would say, well, you know, I had a real gripe about the hips and the eyes and the hair. Like, I was always talking about, you know, the skin tone, especially as a multiracial person, you know, it's like, it's tough. You know, a lot of books are doing blackness in a certain way that doesn't really capture, you know, this and us. And then this side, you know, that's also not capturing us. You know, so trying to figure that out was tough. So I was saying, you know, well, you know, her hair is a little bit curlier, you know, and sending pictures. My hair was much longer then. I mean, the illustrations are straight out of our life. So, you know, and there were very red undertones to the skin color initially, and then a little bit yellow. And so it was, how do we get the brown that's not too brown? And how do we get the sachet in her hips a little so you know she's a woman of color? You know, how do we express this identity that is often so hard to kind of capture? You know, I don't want her to be, or them to be, these kind of racially ambiguous figures. I want people to know that they are mixed and Black, you know. So that was a challenge, but she hit it. And it was a wonderful collaboration. I would do 100 books with Maria. I think she is so talented, and I'm just grateful to her for giving us back this world in the best way, you know. Yeah. I don't think anyone else could have done it, honestly. She was perfect. Yeah. It was a dream.
That's great. I mean, that's what you want to hear. And it's always fascinating to hear about, you know, the collaboration of it and the thought and intention that goes into it, because I think people take that for granted sometimes.
Yeah.
You mentioned point of view earlier, and I want to dig into that a bit while we still have a few minutes. You were inspired, obviously, by motherhood. But you're also writing from the child's perspective in the story, as you should. So there's this duality of it, as far as it's about a child through a child for children, but it's also a profound book for parents. Yes. So I'm curious, kind of how you entered the story yourself, and kind of how you balanced keeping those two parts in mind.
Yes, it was tough. Ronny, I have to tell you, it was very tough because, you know, I was holding his point of view and my own at the same time, obviously. And so I ended up, I think, switching back and forth a little bit in the book. It was very, you know, and that was tricky, you know. So in the beginning, you know, Jackson is bored, bored, bored. You know, he's already eaten his fruit. He's already put Piggy to bed for his nap. He's already, you know, and that was so clearly his point of view. But then when he goes to say, well, Mama, it's time for us to do something, and she's like, you know, I have to finish my work, then it shifts a little bit. You know, so, and then it shifts back again, you know, when he has to figure out, well, what do you want to do when they finally are able to do something? So it was really, trying to hold the truth of the experience. And I think in some ways it became omniscient, you know, almost third person describing both of their experiences. So the point of view is really looking in at them so that each character can have a full experience. And that was the way I handled it. But fundamentally, it's a book about a mother's love for her son, I mean, I think, and a son's deep appreciation for his mother, and the way in which they express that to each other by respecting what the other wants and needs at different times. And so it does flow back and forth, you know, and it supports the mom in her decisions and her needs, and it supports the son in his longing. But I did think about it a lot, and I think I tried to come up with a kind of shared point of view, you know, because really they're both trying to work something out, you know. Both characters are trying to figure out how to find the balance.
I appreciate that it supports both ends of the age spectrum, at least, because I mean, in our line of work, we're often trying to determine whether a book would be good for a group story time, or what is a lap book, what's a one-on-one reading experience. And it's helpful, you know, on a practical level.
Yeah,
if not on an emotional level as well, to have that understanding and know how that book, like, it's clearly a book for a parent and a child to read together.
Yes, you know, that is a very good point. Not to interrupt, I definitely, you know, like I said, the idea of playing with your—I mean, well, anyway, I don't need to repeat that, but I definitely thought about the parent and wanting to give the parent something to relate to, you know. Like, this is about you, parent, reading this book. You know, this is about what I know you're thinking. and you know, and what I know you want to give, and what you're feeling underneath. And so when you're reading this, I want you to feel supported, and I want you to feel connected for sure. 100% I was thinking that.
Yeah. And to do that without sacrificing the child component is a great accomplishment. So.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm so glad you liked it.
I think we have time for just one more question.
Okay.
But it is about what I sort of viewed one of the underlying, or maybe the underlying theme, or conceptual kind of core concept of time. I think the book is built around this idea of time. And I think my favorite line comes at the end when they come back home and Jackson says, "We weren't gone for long, but it felt like forever." And then mom drops this, like, this bomb to me that is kind of cosmic and spiritual and is just kind of everything. She says, "Time is a great mystery and we must use it well." Yes. So I wonder if you could just unpack that line and just say kind of what you hope, what it meant to you and what you hope the young readers take away from that idea.
Yeah, that's a beautiful exchange. I'm so glad it was moving to you. In this book, time is the ultimate place to go. It is the destination. It is, I want kids to realize that it's like a portal, you know, into something, you know. Time is itself a place. And so when you go into time, that means you are resting in the present, you know, in this way. And it can be 2 seconds, it can be an hour, it can be 20 minutes, it can be an afternoon, but time has something to show you. You know, the pause is rich. You don't have to fill it with things all the time. And you can just dwell in time. And when you are dwelling in time together, there's a kind of richness that evolves, you know, that emerges, because you're just there being together. And that's what I love about reading to kids, you know, that you settle in and it's like you're settling into time. No matter what you're reading, it's, you're super present and you feel the connection. You're both focusing on the same thing. And it just becomes like this magical portal. And so I do want kids and parents to think of time as something precious, as something that if you just sink into it and understand it as something not that has to be regulated by the clock, that even the shortest amount can be very, very deep and give you something very, very important. It creates the space for real connection to happen. You know, you can just be quiet together. And I think we all need that. We all need more of that, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, so.
Thank you so much. I wish we had more time because there's so much to say about this book, and I love listening to you talk about it. But that is our time, unfortunately. Thank you so much for sharing and for the book. It's really wonderful.
Thank you so much. I've so enjoyed talking to you about it. Wonderful questions. And hello to all of you out there. I have no idea how many of you are there or what you're thinking or feeling, but I'm really happy that you came and spent this time with us. And I hope that it was healing and beneficial for you. Okay? So I'll see you in the pages of the book.
Yeah, we'll see you there, and we'll see you when the next book comes.
Thank you. Thank
Take
you.
Take care. Bye-bye. And Time for Us will be on shelves on September 10th, I believe. So be sure to check it out. And that was Rebecca Walker. Thank you again.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
So I will do some closing remarks here. Tomorrow, all attendees will receive an email containing links to today's slide presentation, title list, certificate of completion, and video recording. For more about Booklist webinars, be sure to visit booklistonline.com/webinars, where you can view archives of past webinars and register for upcoming ones like those you see here. Whether you are traveling overseas, across the country, or via armchair this summer, we have your next beach read. Subscribe now to get print and digital copies of Booklist and digital and shareable issues of our new patron-friendly product, Booklist Reader, for a special webinar price of $99. In addition to these publications, you will also get archive access, extra online content, and our 2024 Guide to Graphic Novels issue mailing this July, which has happened. Head over to Booklist, to the Booklist website for details. Thank you for joining us for today's webinar. One more huge thank you to Rebecca Walker and to our sponsor, DK. This concludes today's webinar, and we will see you next time.